Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the distinguished lecture of Academia Sinica. Today, our invited speaker is Dr. Jeffrey Ravetch, the winner of Wolf Prize in Medicine 2015. Now, let's welcome the president of Academia Sinica, Dr. Chi-Hui Wong, to deliver the opening remarks. Let's welcome President Wong.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's my great honor and privilege to introduce today's distinguished speaker, Professor Jeff Ravetch. Jeff is currently the Teresa and Eugene Dan Professor at the Rockefeller University and head of the Donald Wagner Laboratory of Molecular Genetics and Immunology. He has made major contributions to the understanding of the effector functions of antibodies and how these functions are associated with the glycosylated Fc domain interacting with various Fc receptors on different immune cells in response to invaders and autoimmune disorders. For his significant work, Professor Ravetch was awarded the 2015 Wolf Prize in Medicine. As you know, antibodies are known to recognize antigens by the FAB domain, but the functions of antibody, including, for example, the antibody-dependent cellular toxicity, so-called ADCC, the complement-dependent cytotoxicity, CDC, and the anti-inflammatory activities against autoimmune disorders, and many others, are often determined by the Fc domain through interaction with various Fc receptors on different immune cells. The activities from this interaction are called effector functions. And Professor Ravetch was the first to elucidate the interactions of the glycosylated Fc domain with various Fc receptors and illustrate how the complex and biantennary N-glycans in the Fc domain play their role in the interactions to exhibit their effector functions. His pioneering work in this area has enabled a new understanding of antibody function, and his work has been used for the development of more effective antibodies for different applications, particularly therapeutic applications. In recognition of his accomplishment, Professor Ravetch has received numerous awards and honors, including just a few examples. The Burroughs Wellcome Scholar Award, the Cody Award from the NCI, National Cancer Institute, in 2007. The Gaynor International Prize in 2012, and as mentioned, the Wolf Prize in Medicine in 2015. He's an elected member of the US National Academy of Sciences, the Institute of Medicine, and the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. Professor Ravetch received his BS degree from Yale University in 1973, the PhD degree from the Rockefeller University in 78, and the MD degree from Cornell University Medical School in 1979. After postdoc research with Philip Dehler at the NIH, Professor Ravetch joined the faculty of Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center and Cornell Medical College in 1982. He moved to Rockefeller in 1996 and was named Teresa and Eugene Dan Professor in 1997. I'm really happy to say that Professor Ravetch is able to accept our invitation to visit Academia Sinica. This is his first time to visit Taiwan as a distinguished lecturer today to deliver a speech on his current research. I should mention that this lectureship is co-sponsored by the Taiwan Biodevelopment Foundation. So thank you very much for coming to the lecture. Ladies and gentlemen, Jeff Ravetch. Yeah.
Well, thank you very much, President Wang. It's really a great honor for me to be standing here on this stage that has hosted so many important scientists and illustrious individuals over the years, and to join their ranks to talk about the work that we've been focused on in my laboratory for the last three decades. So I've entitled today's talk, The Structural Basis for the Functional Diversity of the IgG-Fc Domain. And I'll try to convince you today that despite our understanding of how antibodies work, there's still a lot of surprises in store for us. So let's just begin with a little historical digression and talk about how antibodies were viewed when I began this work some three decades ago. Of course, antibodies had two domains, the variable domain mediated by the FAB sequences that conferred the remarkable ability of antibodies to recognize essentially any antigenic structure that it may ever encounter, and the Fc domain, which was referred to as a constant domain. The problem with this simple binary association is that it doesn't account for the biological phenomenon of what antibodies do. And we know that the constant domain has a dramatic degree of functional diversity. So a constant domain cannot account for the functional diversity of the Fc. And that diversity can be described in two distinct pathways. The effector responses that you heard President Wang talk about, which include the ability of antibodies to kill tumors, to block checkpoints in T cell activation, to engulf pathogens, to neutralize toxins and viruses, trigger pathogenic responses in immune complex diseases like autoimmune diseases, and to suppress those diseases as well. Second arm of the response that antibody FCs contribute to are the afferent responses, the mechanisms by which antibodies are generated and T cells are activated. And the FC domain plays roles in the maturation of dendritic cells, APCs, the activation of B cells, the process by which high affinity antibodies are generated, and even the process by which plasma cells maintain their long-term survival missions. So the obvious question that I try to address is how can a constant domain account for this dramatic degree of diversity? And the simple answer is that the Fc domain isn't constant. It displays significant structural diversity. And there are three major pathways by which diversity is generated. One is, of course, encoded in the genome. It's the various subclasses. In the human, we have four distinct IgG subclasses. Similarly, in the mouse, different species have different subclasses, but we find subclass distribution in all vertebrate species. The second generator of diversity for the Fc comes from the fact that we have different numbers of alleles or allotypes for these various subclasses. But far and away, the greatest driver of diversity comes from the fact that a complex binding ligand is associated with the Fc domain on all IgG antibodies characterized to date. And because glycosylation is a stochastic process, we see significant heterogeneity of glycosylation in the antibody population. So when we begin to add up all these potential mechanisms for generating diversity, it becomes apparent that you can develop over 1,000 different Fc variants for any one variable domain. So we have the mechanisms to generate diversity in the Fc. Does that, in fact, lead to functional heterogeneity? Well, if you look at the Fc domain in a three-dimensional crystal structure, what you see is that there are different regions of the Fc where various binding molecules are known to interact. Fc gamma receptors map to the region, the cleft between the A and B chains, and notice how the glycan in green falls right into that cleft. There are regions on the CH2-CH3 interface where a variety of proteins bind, including CD23, SINR1, FcRn, and so forth. Interestingly, when you start mapping the differences between the subclasses in the human
onto this structure, you find that many of these differences map to the very same regions where we've mapped the various receptor binding molecules. So it leads to the presumption that perhaps different subclasses are genetically encoded to engage different classes of Fc receptors. And we tested that notion early on just by simply taking the mouse subclasses shown here and doing SPR binding studies against the Fc receptors. And what you notice from this slide is that there are, in fact, quite distinct differences in the binding affinities between these receptors and the various subclasses. Most interestingly, from my point of view, was the fact that the ratio between certain certain Fc receptors that are activating receptors and an inhibitory receptor shown here could be calculated. And that ratio of affinity constants, in fact, tells us that certain subclasses were predetermined to engage inhibitory receptors, while other subclasses gave much higher ratios binding to activating subclasses, meaning that there's almost a three log difference between a 2A subclass binding to receptors and the G1 subclass. I seem to be fading in and out as I turn my head, so I have to get used to this. Right. We can test that as a functional system by looking at an antibody which is raised against a melanosome protein in a model of metastatic melanoma. And what we've done is switch the FCs on these antibodies. So it's the same V region, different FCs. And I think it's readily apparent that by changing the FC to a subclass that preferentially engages activating receptors, we in fact generate an antibody which is able to completely eradicate this metastatic melanoma in a mouse lung metastasis model, while the same V region binding to the same antigen when a G1 is attached to its FC shows no distinguishable activity, 2B falling in between. So subclasses, by virtue of their differential FC receptor binding, will confer distinct in vivo biological properties. But as I said, it's the glycan that generates the bulk of our diversity. And shown here is an animation of crystal structures from the database that have different degrees of glycosylation. And what you see is as you truncate the glycan, the arms of the CH2 domain, the A and B arms, in fact, approach each other, closing the gap between these arms where the type 1 FC receptors bind. So that suggested that the glycan could, in fact, modulate the CH2 structure and thereby modulate FC receptor binding. Does that, in fact, hold up? Well, if you deglycosylate FC or generate an FC variant that cannot become glycosylated, the N297Q, you find that there is no FC receptor binding under those circumstances. So clearly, glycosylation of the complex biantennary structure is required for maintaining an open conformation to enable the binding of these type 1 FC receptors. It turns out that this particular phenomenon was not lost upon our microbial friends, and a pathogenic strain of group A strep called S. pyogenes has a virulence factor, which is an enzyme called EndoS, whose only activity is to cleave the glycan off of IgG. When it does so, of course, it will prevent FC receptor engagement to occur, and the consequence of that is to, in fact, prevent these antibodies from engaging the inflammatory process. And you can see that activity by using an autoimmune strain of mice, which develop an inflammatory glomerulonephritis and will die in the absence of any treatment, compared to those same mice with a single injection of this endonuclease, EndoS, from this bacterium. And now you see extended survival solely because by removing the glycan, we prevent the FC from engaging cognate FC receptors and triggering the clearance of these pathogens, or in this case, triggering the activation of inflammatory glomerulonephritis. So to study the glycosylation, as President Wang has beautifully illustrated in a very recent paper, it's important to reduce this complexity to well-defined species, to generate unique conformations of these glycans that you can now attach to an FC, an antibody like rituximab, and investigate the contribution of each of these glycoforms to a biological response like ADCC or the cytotoxicity generated by the antibody. But together with Lai Chi Wang at the University of Maryland, who generated these glycoforms on rituximab, we looked at them and found that there was a very clear distinction that in the presence or absence of fucose, dramatic differences in the ability of these antibodies to trigger ADCC or cytotoxicity was observed. So if you compare the afucosylated in blue to the fucosylated in red, look at the scale, you see a significant difference in their activity. In contrast, when you simply add or subtract the sialic acid from the afucosylated, you see very little change. So the presence or absence of fucose is the major determinant for an antibody developing an ADCC activity. And this is an in vivo phenomenon as well as one we can engineer in the laboratory. What sialation will do, however, is modify ADCC of fucosylated antibodies. So here are the fucosylated antibodies in the presence or absence of sialation, sialic acid, and you see what happens when you introduce sialic acid onto a fucosylated antibody, you in fact reduce its ability to trigger ADCC. In the serum itself, what we find are fucosylated antibodies with and without sialic acid. The afucosylated antibodies do not seem to undergo a sialation reaction. So that seems to correlate with the various modulatory effects that we can determine. So how does fucosylation do this? Right? It does it by virtue of its ability to modify interactions with the type 1 Fc receptor. Crystal structure solved by Peter Sonderman several years ago demonstrated that when you remove the fucose from the core sugar, you now increase the possibility interactions occurring between the glycan on the Fc receptor and the glycan on the Fc. These dotted lines indicate these additional contacts that are made, both hydrogen bonds and van der Waal interactions. And that leads to an overall increase in the affinity between FcR3 and the afucosylated Fc itself. All right, so I mentioned that these are Fc receptors. We've talked about the type 1 receptors. These are the ones that trigger inflammatory responses. They come in both activating forms as well as an inhibitory form. And the inhibitory form in this type of reaction acts to set a threshold for cellular responses, by which I mean when you have co-expression of both activating and inhibitory receptors, it's the ratio of those receptors that determines whether an immune complex will reach a concentration that will allow for cellular activation to occur. But there's a second class of Fc receptors that we discovered in the last 5 years, and these are type 2 Fc receptors. They're members of the C-type lectin family. They include CD23 and DC-sine. Well, as the name would imply, you would suspect that these lectins are that these receptors are binding to carbohydrate determinants. But that's not the case. They are C-type lectins, but what they bind to are, in fact, different Fc conformations that are generated by changes in glycosylation. So it's not the direct interaction of these lectins with their carbohydrates, but rather what the carbohydrates do to the Fc that permit different protein-protein interactions. The type 1 receptors bind to IgG complexes that are primarily acylated, while the type 2 receptors uniquely bind to immune complexes that have achieved a sialation of the glycan. Why is this the case? Why should sialation affect the conformation of the Fc? All right. So in studies we did with Pamela Bjorkman several years ago, we looked at crystal structures generated for a human Fc that was either fully sialated or acylated, and in fact superimpose the acylated structures upon the structures found in the database. And what you see is consistent with all prior structures of acylated Fcs, which is they all form into a very tight open conformation, all quite homogeneous in their structure. But when you introduce sialation onto the Fc, something remarkable happens. You now increase the conformational flexibility of the Fc, so you now find crystals in both open conformations, closed conformations, and intermediate conformations. So sialation is destabilizing the CH2 domain to allow for the sampling of different conformal states. This happens, we think, because of a very interesting shift that occurs in the FC structure. Let me just walk you through the conformation of the FC in the open form, shown in these various noodle forms, if you will, are the glycan chains. In red is the 1,6 chain, in yellow is the 1,3 chain, and it's the 1,3 chain that projects into the groove formed by the A and B chains of the CH2 domain. Okay, so this is the open conformation. This is where the type 1 receptors will bind, and the type 2 receptors are unable to bind in this conformation. When you introduce sialic acid onto the 1,3 arm in particular, you force a conformational change so that now the 1,3 arm moves out of this pocket and forms contacts to the CH2 domain shown here. In fact, it falls into a beautiful pocket that's formed by Glu318 and Lys340, where only a 2,6 conformation would be able to make contact with the type 2 receptor. So by so doing, we close this structure and enable the opening of the type 2 receptor binding sites. So what sialation does is it governs a switch between type 1 and type 2 receptors. Asialated or type 1, sialated or type 2. So the glycan, in fact, can regulate both type 1 and type 2 FCR interactions. In the case of the fucosylation, it's the major determinant for the FCR3 binding. In the presence of fucose, we have a tenfold lower affinity for this activating receptor than in the absence of fucose. In contrast, when we add sialic acid to the fucosylated species, we reduce the binding affinity by several fold for the activating receptors, but more importantly, we acquire the ability to bind to a different class of receptors, the type 2 receptors. Functionally, what this means is that in the presence and absence of fucose, we can modify the ability of an antibody to mediate cytotoxicity, and in the presence of absence of sialic acid, we can modify the ability of the antibody to suppress inflammation in this model of arthritis, for example. And it's this interaction that is the basis for the anti-inflammatory properties of intravenous gamma globulin. Once again, these sialic acid closed conformations allow for the binding to this type 2 receptor, open conformations the type 1 receptor. So we can now understand how the conformational changes that occur in the FC can engage different classes of receptors. And in this animation, you can look at the type 1 receptors, which bind in a 1-to-1 complex with the FC, intercalating into this groove formed by the A and B chains in the open form, while the type 2 receptors make protein-protein contacts in a 2-to-1 ratio with the CH2-CH3 interface. And most interestingly, when the type 2s bind, it closes this pocket, preventing type 1s from binding. And conversely, when type 1s bind, the type 2 sites seem to be obscured. So nature has evolved this really elegant mechanism to diversify FC structure, post-translational manner to modify its biological properties. So what are these properties? Well, there are lots of them. And when I sat down to put together this lecture, it's always a choice as to which pathways we'll talk about. So I decided to focus on three pathways. The ADCC pathway that we talked about, regulated by fucosylation. The ability of antibodies to neutralize viruses and toxins. And finally, the modulation or the immunomodulatory pathway in which antibodies can actually feed back on their own maturation and synthesis. So the three case studies I want to describe are anti-tumor therapeutic antibodies and how antibody-FC interactions govern the biological and therapeutic property of these antibodies, how antibody-mediated antiviral protection engages different classes of receptors, and finally, the molecular basis for the anti-inflammatory activity of IVIG. All right. So let's begin with antibodies in cancer therapy. Now a field which is about 15 years old and is yet to see its peak. I think we're looking at a decade of expanding products on the market that will have significant impact on patients' health and survival. So antibodies can work in a variety of ways against tumor cells. They can directly impact on a tumor cell antigen in the absence of any secondary interactions. So a direct effect on a particular critical structure on the tumor cell. This you'll see is a case that we have yet to encounter. More generally, antibodies couple recognition of a tumor antigen to effector cell pathways, either by triggering NK cell activation to perform a killing reaction like ADCC, or macrophage Fc receptors to allow for the engulfment and clearance of tumor cells. And finally, antibodies can modify the immune response itself by which APCs interact with effector cells to trigger a T-cell mediated response. So in each of these cases, it turns out that Fc interactions play an important and critical role in the in vivo activity. So this story really began about 15 years ago with the first approvals of antibodies for the treatment of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma using rituximab, anti-CD20, or metastatic breast carcinoma, the anti-HER2 new antibody. And I was curious at that time to determine if those antibodies showing clinical response worked through their suggested mechanisms, which were Fc independent, or in fact required Fc interactions. So in these studies, we took xenograft mouse models, human tumors growing in the mice, and treated the mice with the antibodies as used in the clinic, and replicated very nicely the ability of the antibody to modulate this tumor growth to prevent tumors from killing this nude mouse. But in the same treatment protocol, an animal that was lacking the activating Fc receptors, type 1 receptors, showed no ability to clear the tumor despite therapeutic levels of antibody. So in this case, it was quite clear that the antibody required Fc receptor interactions to mediate its anti-tumor effect. The same was true for Herceptin, despite the fact that here we had a well-defined target that was a growth factor receptor, HER2-nu, that was thought to mediate the inhibition of an autocrine loop. And in fact, in vitro, the antibody Herceptin was quite effective at inhibiting tumor growth in culture. So we modify the Herceptin antibody, put a single point mutation in the Fc domain, CH2 domain, and that point mutation abrogates all Fc receptor binding. So now we could ask, what happens if we use that antibody in a in vitro assay? And there was no difference. The antibody does, in fact, modulate tumor growth by blocking an autocrine loop. But in vivo, an Fc mutated antibody loses its ability to control tumor growth in an animal. So in vivo, the activity that dominates was the anti-tumor activity ADCC. Well, these studies were followed by others in different laboratories in clinical observations that really confirm that these antibodies are cytotoxic, and that's their mechanism of action. If you look at patients being treated for their tumors with anti-CD20 or anti-HER2-nu, what you observe is that patients stratify into two populations. Those that respond relatively well to the treatment and have an extended survival, and those that unfortunately respond poorly or don't respond at all and therefore have a shortened survival. And the differences between these populations, both for CD20 and for HER2-nu treatment, were in fact that same activating Fc receptor that's involved in ADCC, confirming that, in fact, ADCC was a determining component of the in vivo activity of the antibody. Well, it certainly stands to reason that if you want to generate a more effective antibody for NHL, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, or for breast carcinoma using these scaffolds, you'll modify the Fc to enhance its FcR3 binding activity or its ADCC. And that experiment was performed by scientists at Glycart, which was later acquired by Roche. And the drug that was developed, a Fc-modified version of anti-CD20, enhancing cytotoxicity by enhancing FcR3 binding, showed a one-year improvement in survival in chronic lymphocytic leukemia. Well, this was confirmation and also big news. You had this important extension in survival. But it troubled me, because if you look at the long-term survival, not much has happened. we really haven't impacted significantly. These two curves have no significant difference out at this point in the long-term survival. So why is that? Why aren't we able to improve not only short-term survival, but long-term survival? Right. So we pose a hypothesis. How can long-term survival be enhanced? Could immune complexes generated by ADCC engage Fc receptors on dendritic cells to prime a long-term anti-tumor cellular immune response? Right. Now, why do we pose this particular hypothesis? Well, many years before, almost 10 years before, we had demonstrated in an animal tumor model that you could, in fact, use immune complexes to activate dendritic cells to lead to cytotoxic T cell killing of a tumor, but only if the dendritic cells were engaging an activating Fc receptor on those cells. Dendritic cells, like most of the immune cells, express both activating and inhibitory receptors, and the immune complex will engage both. Thresholds are not achieved that will lead to dendritic cell activation and T cell stimulation. Right. But you can get this to work. So we wondered if it's possible to examine these same kinds of reactions for the anti-CD20 response. Right. So the hypothesis was that, or the observation was, that when you have minimal engagement of the activating receptor, because inhibitory receptors are engaged, you see very little DC activation by the immune complex. But if you engage the activating receptors preferentially, you can induce DC maturation, enhance antigen presentation, cytokine release, and of course, the expression of costimulatory molecules like B7 family members, leading to augmentation of T cell activation that will lead to anti-tumor responses. So the experimental system that was developed by Dave DeLillo, a postdoctoral fellow in the laboratory, took a tumor cell, a lymphoma cell DL4, expressed human CD20 in this cell, and then used this to generate tumors in mice. And in fact, if you add this to a mouse, the mouse will in fact die. You can treat the mouse with the anti-human CD20 antibody rituximab, or its mouse homolog, and the mice will survive. And this survival, of course, is dependent upon the mice having intact activating Fc receptors, just as we showed a decade before. So this is the ADCC clearance. All right. So now you have a surviving population of mice that have seen the tumor, seen the antibody, and have survived. You stop treating with antibody, and you wait 3 months. And a painful thing to do to a postdoc, but you wait 3 months. And then you re-challenge the mice with the very same tumor you started with. And when you do that, if you re-challenge with the very same tumor, you find the mice will all survive. So they have developed a memory response against this tumor. And what's interesting is that they'll only survive if they're being treated with the tumor expressing the antigen that the antibody has targeted. If they just express the parental tumor itself, they all die. There's no recall response, there's no memory response against the tumor background, it's against the antigen that our antibody has targeted. Or if they haven't seen the prior treatment, these mice will all die as well. So what's the basis for this survival that occurs and this long-term response? Right. So since we had our dendritic cell hypothesis, we generated mouse strains that were selectively deficient in the activating receptor on dendritic cells in the mouse that we thought was involved. And when you now repeat that experiment, comparing the mice that have activating receptors on all their cells or have lost the activating receptor on dendritic cells, in the primary challenge, it makes no difference. Of course not. Dendritic cells are not mediating cytotoxicity. Right? It's the macrophage NK cells that are protecting these mice. But now we have two populations of mice to re-challenge. Wait 3 months, re-challenge, and now you see a significant difference between the mice that expressed activating receptor on their dendritic cells and those that did not. So in fact, the presence of an activating receptor on dendritic cell was key to the mechanism by which a recall response or memory response was elicited in these primed animals. That's in fact the generation of a T cell population. You can do adoptive transfer studies using the same protocol, but now instead of re-challenging after 3 months, just isolating T cells from these primed animals, implanting them into a naive recipient, challenging with tumor, and these mice will survive if they've been primed with the antibody, tumor cell expressing the antibody. All right, so let's look at what happens in the real world of antibody therapeutics. So there are a large number of Fc-optimized anti-tumor antibodies that are in various stages of clinical studies, some approaching approval. And what you see is that these antibodies are all optimized for cytotoxicity by enhancing FcR3a binding. Well, that makes perfect sense. That's what we said to people back in 2000. Antibodies mediate cytotoxicity. That's how you kill tumors. So will 3a binding enhancement be sufficient to not only drive cytotoxicity, but drive this T cell memory response? Let's look at the expression of Fc receptors in mice and in humans. Right, so both species express classes of Fc receptors. If you look at the receptors that are involved in cytotoxicity on macrophages and NK cells in human, it's a receptor called FcR3a. Right, that's what you do to enhance cytotoxicity. You enhance 3a binding. In the mouse, it's R4 on macrophages and dendritic cell. It's a homolog of 3a in the mouse. But on dendritic cells, something unfortunate has happened. In the mouse, the same receptor involved in cytotoxicity is also expressed on the dendritic cell, but not so in the human. In the human, a different activating receptor, 2a, is now expressed in place of 3a. So will 2a substitute for 3a in this ability to engage the response? And will an antibody enhanced for 3a binding manage to engage 2a? Well, the second part we can answer right away. The answer is no. When you engineer for 3a enhancement, you don't engineer for 2a binding. So they'll be lacking that. But we have to be able to test that notion. So to test it, we need an animal model. An animal model that expresses human Fc receptors on the appropriate cells as found in the human. So to do that, we generated a mouse that we first deleted the mouse Fc receptors, shown here, and then we transplanted a large chromosomal fragment using a back transgenic approach of human DNA so that the human Fc receptors were being expressed under their own promoters. Right. So in principle, these mice will express human Fc receptors on mouse cells, but in a pattern reminiscent of the human, not of the mouse. Right. So do these mice actually work? The answer is yes, they do. You can now go back to our metastatic melanoma model. And now instead of using mouse antibodies, we use human antibodies. Human G1, a human Fc that's been modified to enhance activating receptors, or a human Fc that's null for Fc receptor binding. I think you can see very clearly that these antibodies will reflect their biological potency by engaging their appropriate Fc receptors. For most importantly for our experiment right now, the 2A receptor, which is not found in the mouse, is expressed in these transgenic mice, these humanized FCR mice, on mouse dendritic cells. Mouse macrophages will also express 2A and 3A in the mouse as they would in the human. So all the pieces are in place to do the experiment, except for the antibodies. So we now need antibodies that will distinguish between the activating 2A receptor and the activating 3A receptor. Well, fortunately, point mutations can be introduced into a human G1 Fc that will accomplish this. So this mutation, G to A mutation, will enhance 2A binding without changing 2B or 3A binding. This double mutation, ALIE, will enhance 3A binding and not affect 2A binding. And we can combine these two into a mutation that enhances 2A and 3A binding and not change the inhibitory receptor. So we have antibodies that will distinguish between these various receptors on different cellular populations. So here's the experiment, right? So we do our tumor cell expressing human CD20. Now what we use for treatment are antibodies against CD20 that either preferentially bind the macrophage Fc receptor, 3A, dendritic cell Fc receptor, 2A, or both macrophage and dendritic cell receptor, 2A plus 3A. So the survivors, of course, are the cytotoxic receptors, macrophage and macrophage over here. The dendritic cell enhanced binder doesn't provide any survival advantage, just like we saw in our original mouse conditional knockout experiment. We now rechallenge these mice 3 months later, the survivors, and you see the only mice that survive rechallenge are the ones where the FC could engage both 3A for cytotoxicity and 2A for dendritic cell maturation. If you only engage the activating receptor for cytotoxicity, you don't provide this long-term survival advantage. So that's the bad news, that all these re-engineered antibodies, which will improve short-term survival, will not accomplish the goal of long-term survival. For that, we need a next generation of antibody. But the good news is we know how to do that. So how does it work? So the vaccinal effect, as we call it, for CD20, and we believe it can be extended to other tumor antigens, involves the binding of the antibody to the tumor cell, triggering FC receptor-mediated killing or phagocytosis by NK cells and macrophages, leading to the generation of immune complexes against the antigenic determinant that the antibody recognized, CD20. These immune complexes, if their FCs can engage the activating receptor on dendritic cells preferentially, will lead to the maturation of these cells, as Ralph Steinman would have said, inducing class II expression, B7 upregulation, changing, converting naive B cells and T cells into effector cells, and that goes on to generate a memory response. So manipulating the T cell compartment is clearly a very effective way at generating not only anti-tumor responses, but potentially long-term responses. Right? And that underlies the explosion in activity around a collection of antigens on tumor cells as well as on T cells that can modulate T cell activation. Anti-CTLA-4, for example, anti-PD-1, and you can read for yourself lots of other inhibitory receptors on T cells, as well as agonistic receptors on dendritic cells like CD40, or targets on tumor cells like PD-L1 that's also found on other myeloid populations. So do these antibodies show a dependence on FC receptor engagement and FC modulation? Without going through all the data, we recently published it. It turns out that it does in many cases. Anti-CTLA-4, for example, shown in this metastatic melanoma model I showed you before, done in collaboration with Jim Allison, will protect these animals from their fatal disease. In an intact background, mice lacking FC gamma receptors show no enhanced survival. And that's because the antibody not only blocks an inhibitory receptor on T cells, but also depletes T regulatory cells through an ADCC mechanism that requires FC receptors. PD-L1 will show a similar requirement. PD-L1 that's able to engage FC receptors, activating receptors, has a far improved survival benefit over PD-L1 that does not have that capacity in these tumor models. This is an MC38 colon carcinoma model. And that's because anti-PD-L1 will deplete these intratumoral myeloid suppressor cells and thereby confer an immunostimulatory microenvironment to lead to tumor cell killing. Other classes of antibodies that regulate the T cell response, the agonistic antibodies to anti-CD40, which will be mimicking the CD40 ligand to induce dendritic cell maturation and our T cell activation pathway. These antibodies, very promising candidates, turn out to also require FC engagement, but in a very interesting mechanism. The normal interaction between CD40 ligand and CD40 is a trimeric ligand and a trimeric receptor, leading to this critical clustering to trigger an agonistic signal to give rise to the dendritic cell maturation. Antibodies, as you can see, will dimerize, and dimerization is not sufficient to induce this maturation signal. So in order to get an antibody to mimic the ligand, it needs some scaffold or some way to be cross-linked. And that's provided by the FC if it can engage the inhibitory FC receptor. Why the inhibitory receptor? Because the activating receptor would kill the APC, and you don't want that to happen. The inhibitory receptor will act as a scaffold in the absence of signaling that will allow for this clustering to occur. And you can, in fact, enhance that clustering by enhancing inhibitory receptor binding. Right. So there are three different classes of interactions by these immunomodulatory antibodies. The depletion reactions that take place by anti-CTLA-4, anti-GITR, anti-OX40, where the target is a T regulatory cell, for example, or a myeloid suppressor cell, and that leads to the depletion of those cells and the activation of more T effector responses. The agonistic signals for anti-CD40 and other anti-TNF receptor superfamily members, where the Fc acts as a scaffold to cluster receptors that require multimerization for their activity, and the intermediate forms, which have components of both, like anti-Marco, that I won't be discussing right now. So there's a lot of interactions for these immunomodulatory antibodies that engage Fc receptor interactions, both through cross-linking, through cytotoxicity, and through their ability to modulate the tumor microenvironment. Let's move on to the second case study, which is regulating the afferent response. Right? And that's the pathway shown here, where immune complexes can engage the B cell itself to modify B cell signaling. Well, we know that happens because the affinity maturation pathway selects somatically mutated, hypermutated B cell receptors on immune complexes. The FDC retains immune complexes. It doesn't retain antigen in the absence of antibody. So antibody is always present to engage, through its FC, specific receptors. How does that regulate an antibody response? So we turn to the influenza vaccine system. Remember, the influenza RNA virus is coated on its surface by two classes of spike proteins, the so-called HA, or hemagglutinin protein, and the neuraminidase, or sialidase protein. And that the antibodies that are found upon immunization with HA, or with the flu vaccine, lead to protection, and that correlates with antibodies that neutralize HA. So what's HA, the spike protein? It has two domains, a globular head, which is the part of the protein that mutates quite rapidly. And that's why we need seasonal vaccines when we do flu vaccination. And then there's a stalk domain, which is conserved among many different flu serotypes. And the stalk domain can be conserved. If you can target the stalk domain, you can get broader protection against a variety of flu variants. So we decided to do a patient study to look at the changes that occur upon immunization with the approved flu vaccine. This is an open label study of IgG Fc glycan composition in human immunity, where the study population are normal healthy adults, and we're vaccinating with the flu trivalent inactivated vaccine, the one that was the 2012-13 season. Standard administration, sampling every week, looking at serum and looking at PBMCs. And what we were after in this experiment was to, in fact, look not only at the development of anti-flu antibodies, their neutralizing capacity, but if there are any changes that occur in their glycan composition on the FC. Because changes in glycan on the FC could, in fact, tell us if specific FC receptor pathways were being engaged during an immunization response. And the results really were beyond our expectations. So shown in blue is the level of sialic acid on the anti-HA antibodies. And shown in red is the level of afucosylated glycans on the anti-HA antibodies. Once again, the afucosylated represent the type 1 Fc receptor binding structure. The sialylated Fcs, the type 2 Fc receptor binding structures. So at day 7, which is the day at which plasmablast expansion occurs in flu vaccination, we see a very noticeable peak in the composition of the anti-HA antibodies against the flu vaccine in their sialic acid content. In contrast, at week 3, that drops down dramatically, and we see a spike in the afucosylated population. So day 7 has a type 2 FC receptor binding profile, and by week 3, we have a type 1 FC receptor binding profile. But what does that mean? Why are we seeing these changes? Do they have any significance in the response itself? So we started to do correlation. Does the change in sialation lead to any change in neutralizing antibody capacity or change in affinity of the antibodies? And shown here is the relationship between neutralizing activity and sialic acid. With higher sialation, we get higher neutralizing capacity in the population of antibodies by week 3, and we get a higher affinity for the anti-HA antibodies by week 3 as well. Right. So sialation was in fact a biomarker for the development of higher affinity, more potent neutralizing antibodies against flu. Okay, that's the data. Why? What is the mechanism behind it? Right, so we started to look to see what does sialated FC engage in the B cell antibody reaction. Well, it engages a molecule called CD23, which is a marker of B cell activation with not much known in terms of its function. But when you engage immune complexes that have these sialated FCs with a PBMC population, what you see is that the consequence of cross-linking CD23 is to upregulate another FC receptor, the type 1 inhibitory receptor FCR2B. The same was true for a B cell, human B cell line called BJAB. Dose-dependent fashion, you could see using now a sialated monoclonal antibody against the HA. As you increase the dose of sialated immune complexes, you increase the surface expression of this inhibitory 2B receptor. So you can now take these sialated complexes and inject them into mice and ask, do these sialated complexes lead to upregulation of this inhibitory receptor on B cells in vivo? And it does so. Here you see the sialated immune complexes compared to the asialated or neuraminidase treated population. Clearly an increase in 2B expression on B cells in these mice that are injected with the sialated complexes composed of anti-HA antibody and HA alone. And if you do it in our mouse models lacking CD23, now scoring for germinal center B cells, the relevant population from our opinion, you see that the upregulation of inhibitory receptors by sialated complexes is CD23 dependent. So that told us that at least one mechanism seemed to involve sialation of the antibody to generate immune complexes that can now engage CD23 germinal center B cells, leading to upregulation of 2B expression. And that leads to higher affinity antibodies. So now looking at the affinity in vivo of those immunized animals, we see sialated complexes leading to higher affinity HA antibodies that are CD23 dependent. And most strikingly, the antibodies for which the higher affinity is seen are targeting the stalk domain. The anti-head domain antibodies actually are already high affinity. There's no enhancement with immune complexes, but the stalk domain show a nice enhancement. All right, so why does 2B lead to this? Well, we had shown years before that the 2B receptor sitting on B cells in the germinal center acts as a regulator of thresholds for B cell activation. The immune complex, once again, is what's driving affinity maturation and selection. It has an FC domain. If that FC domain engages the inhibitory receptor as well as the BCR through antigen, then we gate the signal. As you increase the signal strength of the inhibitory receptor, you require higher and higher affinity antibodies on the B cell side to allow these activated B cells to escape germinal center and go on to become plasma cells or memory B cells. So this was a mechanism by which early immune complex generation led to the generation of higher affinity antibodies. But would those higher affinity antibodies that were against the stalk offer any enhancement in protection? Right. So to do that, you take those serum from the mice we immunized with the immune complexes, sialated or asialated, passively transfer into a naive animal, and challenge with flu virus. And you can challenge with homologous virus, meaning the HA head is the same in this virus as the HA head in the immunizing population. Or you can challenge with heterologous virus, where the HA head is different, but the stalk is conserved. And what you see is that in a homologous situation, it doesn't matter if you have silated or acylated immune complexes, the anti-head response is protective. That's how flu vaccines work. They generate anti-head antibodies, they're seasonally protective, they prevent flu from infecting recipient cells. But cross-protection against a different HA head is not seen if you don't have the immune complexes comprised of silated FCs. And the same is true for yet a more distantly related strain, where once again, the only protection you see is when you immunize with silated immune complexes, take that serum, passively transfer into this mouse, and challenge with this heterologous virus. If you have acylated complexes or do it in a mouse lacking CD23, you don't see this protection. So the mechanism that we've stumbled upon in these experiments is a component of how antibody maturation occurs. That upon immunization with antigen, immune complexes can be formed. By day 7, those immune complexes can have enhanced sialic acid. By enhancing the sialic acid, we actually now convert those antibodies to those that can engage CD23 on those germinal center B cells, leading to upregulation of the inhibitory 2B receptor that raises the threshold required for affinity selection, and we get higher affinity B cells to come out of that system. With higher affinity anti-stalk B cells, we in fact now are able to see protection against heterologous strains where the heads have drifted in various flu isolates, but the stalks remain relatively conserved. So we think this is a more general phenomenon, not just confined to flu. We're doing it in HIV. And we think this might be a way of bootstrapping a vaccine response by using immune complexes instead of pure antigen. And the immune complexes, if they're able to target the CD23 pathway, can lead to selection of higher affinity, broadly reactive antibodies. So in the remaining 5 minutes, I just want to give the third case study, which is how high-dose intravenous gamma globulin works. So this is a mysterious compound preparation. It was developed about 50 years ago as a replacement therapy for mostly children or immunocompromised adults who don't generate significant levels of IgG antibodies. Those patients are at risk for developing various infections, particularly from encapsulated bacteria. So to get that heterogeneity of FAB responses, you need many thousands of donors. So these preparations are serum fractions taken from 10,000 donors or more. What was found about 30 years ago was that if you use 1 to 2 grams per kilogram, and that's truly grams, not milligrams, gram per kilogram of this heterogeneous mixture of IgG, you can in fact affect the development of inflammatory autoimmune diseases. Right. Truly a mysterious phenomenon. We knew the FC fragments were active in some clinical studies, and it's been approved by the FDA for treatment of these 4 autoimmune diseases: immune thrombocytopenia, Kawasaki's, Guillain-Barré syndrome, and chronic inflammatory demyelinating polyneuropathies, all autoimmune diseases, all of which have, you know, either autoreactive T cells or antibodies. Because it's a relatively safe preparation, it's used off-label in about 85 different autoimmune indications. It's a common treatment in the clinic for patients that have autoimmune diseases. Right. Why should this work? I mean, it seems to make no sense whatsoever. Right. So you can imagine there were as many theories about its activity as there were scientists who were investigating it. And we decided to wade into this story as well by setting up in vivo models. Once again, let's look to see, is there in fact an anti-inflammatory activity for IVIG? Let's use IVIG and do a straightforward experiment. This is, we use several different in vivo models. This is a model of arthritis, where you induce arthritis in the mice. You suppress inflammation by using IVIG out of the bottle, 1 gram per kilogram, it works. And then if you take that same preparation, cleave off the glycan with PNGSF, you lose activity. Well, that was dramatic, right? So there was a glycan requirement for this preparation to show its anti-inflammatory suppressive activity. So we then took a systematic approach to cleave off as many glycans as we could, and we found that when you cleave off the terminal sialic acid, you found the same loss of activity. You desialate it and you lose the protective activity. Well, if you look at the population of IGs in the IVIG that are sialated, it's about 5%. So the high dose requirement might simply come from the fact that there's very little active material in our preparation. Let's enhance it. Let's enrich the sialated fraction using a lectin affinity chromatography approach. SNA lectin works nicely. And now you can enrich it by tenfold. So instead of 5%, we have 50% sialic acid on our IVIG. And let's drop the dose by a factor of 10. So now at 0.1 gram per kilogram, we see protection in our fractionated IVIG preparation. But at 0.1 gram per kilogram of unfractionated IVIG, there's no protection. So that was, you know, quite an interesting observation. The sialated species was responsible for the anti-inflammatory activity. We could manipulate it and see activity. Right. We now know that sialated IgG binds to the type 2 Fc receptor pathway, in this case DC sine, and that's responsible for its activity. But this suggested a therapeutic product. If you can increase the degree of sialation on IVIG, you can reduce the dosing requirement from 1 gram per kilogram to 100 mg per kg, still high, but better. Right? And in fact, a company called Momenta has in fact taken that as an approach. They've used an in vitro glycosylation mechanism to enhance the amount of sialation on IVIG using a scalable product. Pathway, and they now have about 90% sialic acid on their IVIG. And sure enough, when you increase it, it is potent at 0.1 gram per kilogram. Here's a model of blistering, autoimmune blistering skin disease, pemphigus, at 0.1 gram per kilogram of sialated IVIG. You see, you know, very nice recovery of that animal. In various arthritis models, you see once again that you can drop the dose by at least a factor of 10 to get protection. So this can be developed as a clinical product. But we're of course more interested in the underlying biological mechanism. IVIG is still pretty messy to work with. Can we make a recombinant form? Can we take a human IgG1 Fc and increase the degree of sialation by expressing it, for example, in a cell line that has been transfected with ST6Gal1, the sialotransferase that's responsible for sialation of the 2,6 position. And in fact, you can do that. And by doing that, you can in fact increase the potency of the product by about 35-fold. And now it's not quite homogeneous, but it's certainly a recombinant version with a more well-defined glycan composition. And if you use that material in an arthritis model in an animal lacking the type 2 receptor, DC sine homolog, you don't see protection. And you can reintroduce the human homolog as a transgene and look at the pause. You can suppress inflammation in those animals. Right. So we thought this was a step in the right direction, making a recombinant product, but it still requires controlling glycosylation. Can we do this without changing glycan composition? So the clue for that came from the crystal structures. So I told you before that, together with Pamela Bjorkman, a crystal structure was solved for the sialated Fc. And we compared the crystal structures for the sialated Fc to the asialated Fc, and noticed something quite interesting, that there's an amino acid, phenylalanine 241, that makes a stacking contact interaction with the branching mannose of the, with the mannose of the 1,3 arm of the glycan, right? So this stacking interaction might stabilize the glycan to keep it in that cleft between the A and B chains. And when it's silated, we see a rotation of that glycan by 90 degrees, breaking that stacking interaction. So can we mutate that phenylalanine and in fact phenocopy silylation? So we generated a mutation of phenylalanine 241 to alanine, FA241, and found that FA241 is anti-inflammatory with or without sialic acid being added to it. Compared to wild-type FC, where sialation was absolutely required for anti-inflammatory activity, in this case, there was no such requirement, but FA241 still required the presence of the type 2 receptor for its activity to work, and still signaled downstream of its type 2 receptor to generate IL-33. So we can phenocopy the sialation by a point mutation and thereby introduce into an FC this conformational flexibility that will allow type 2 receptor binding. So we've taken that a bit further now and looked at how to use that approach for not only antibody-triggered inflammatory diseases, but T-cell diseases. IVIG paradoxically seems to work on T-cell diseases as well, like MS. So can we, in fact, model that in EAE? And yes, we can. Here is an EAE model, suppressing with IVIG, desilylating with neuraminidase, you lose the activity. FA241 works very nicely to protect the animals as well as IVIG. And now we're using doses of FA241 that are within biological or pharmaceutical range, 10 to 20 mg per kg. And once again, you can demonstrate that the mechanism by which FA241 suppresses inflammation or IVIG suppresses inflammation in EAE is through T regulatory cells. If we deplete T regulatory cells, you lose that protective effect. So let me just, last slide of this part of the talk, summarize how silated FC as IVIG or silated FC as normal components of the immune response. Remember, as we sit here today, our bodies are being bathed in 10 mg per mil of IgG. That could be quite potently inflammatory if we didn't have a way of suppressing the inflammatory activity. Silylation does that. So even at a 5 to 10% level of silylation, it's enough to suppress the ability of the IgG to trigger an inflammatory response. It does so because it binds to a type 2 receptor, DC sign, on regulatory maxodendritic cells, releases IL-33, which can act on multiple cellular populations. It can act on innate leukocytes, like basophils, to lead to IL-4 secretion, and IL-4 at a local site of inflammation will induce inhibitory 2B receptor binding, thereby suppressing inflammation. IL-33 can also bind to its receptor SD2 on T regulatory cells, leading to their expansion and activation, and Tregs can suppress both Th1 and Th17 pathways. So what I've tried to show you today is that the FC interactions are in fact central to many immune responses, both antibody triggered as well as T-cell mediated. They modulate the immune response. They're responsible for therapeutic activity of different classes of antibodies, both for anti-tumor responses as well as toxin and virus neutralization. And they really underlie a central mechanism by which the immune system is able to both mediate protective responses, prevent autoreactivity, and lead to homeostatic control. So I'd like to thank the people in my laboratory who've carried out these studies, a series of really excellent postdocs, Stelios Bournazos, Ronnie Dahan, David DeLillo, Jade Mamari, and Taya Wang. Our lab manager is Patrick Smith. We've collaborated over the years with a variety of laboratories, Jim Allison, Pam Bjorkman, Michelle Nussensweig, Peter Palazzi, and Patrick Wilson. And with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention and take any questions you might have.
So let me start with that memory.
The memory effect.
Yeah. What would be the optimal glycan for the 2A?
Yeah, so 2A does not show a glycan dependence, right? I mean, so right, beyond generating a G2 or a G2 after won't make right. a difference. So I think having asilylated will give 3A enhancement, yeah. And then probably a point mutation in the FC that will enhance 2A binding.
So it's better to engineer the protein.
So I think it's, you can do a combination of both or just engineer the FC. Okay. But the truth is, I'm not sure we've done enough studies yet with possible glycan variants that might lead to 2A enhancement. So there might be a glycan that will do both. We haven't come across it. It's probably not part of the normal repertoire that we've looked at, but it's a worthwhile endeavor.
Okay, any questions? Okay, Alice.
Thank you. You talk about IgG. What about IgM? Does the FC portion of IgM has any functions?
IgA. M, IgM. Oh, I'm sure the FC portion has functions. IgM is quite different than IgG. So it's glycosylation. It has four N-link glycosylation sites. Two are high mannose, two are complex biantennary. We know at least one of those sites on the CH1 domain is in fact critical for assembly with the surrogate light chain. In the absence of that site, you in fact get no B cells. That's pretty important. So we know that glycan plays a very important role in B cell development. But the FC is quite different in its CH2, CH3, CH4 configuration. And IgM, because it naturally exists as a pentameric structure, will in fact mediate a complement triggered pathway. So the classical pathway of complement activation seems to be dominant for IgM. For IgG, the complement pathway does not seem to contribute significantly to the in vivo activity of IgG antibodies. So it's an open question what the other glycosylation sites are doing, why they're so tightly controlled in terms of their glycan composition. Why are some high mannose, why are some complex biantennary, and could they influence other types of interactions? I think it's a question. It's one that I've posed to my fellows for several years now, and no one has taken the bait. So perhaps someone in the audience will. I think it's definitely worthwhile looking at.
The reason I'm interested is, as you know, the carbohydrate antigen tends to elicit mostly IgM. So you wonder, other than CDC, do they do anything else?
Right.
And what about the natural occurring alpha-1-3 gal?
Right.
What do they do?
Right. So, I mean, you certainly can get IgG responses to glycans if you have T cell help. So glycoconjugates, as you know, will of course give rise to an IgG T cell dependent response. But in the absence of a conjugate, the carbohydrate itself in the mouse, for example, is G1 and G3, will be the IgG subclasses. And it acts more as an innate receptor pathway, binding to marginal zone B cells, directly triggering B cell activation. In the human, the IgG subclasses, are also skewed in terms of their activity. I think, the way I think about IgM is that it's that first 3-day response in a naive individual that gives you the survival benefit to mount an IgG response, and those IgM immune complexes are able to initiate the pathway of class switching that leads ultimately to the effective IgG responses. I should point out that the same rules of glycosylation and FC structure apply to IgE. IgE has a very similar FC structure in the CH3, CH4 domains as IgG does. But what's very curious about IgE, that even though it has a glycan that's similar and required for type 1 FC receptor binding, it has several substitutions in the CH3 domain that spontaneously confer conformational flexibility on the FC. So IgE will alternate between open and closed conformations binding type 1 and type 2 receptors in the absence of sialation, while IgG has generated a regulatory pathway for those same interactions. It's why I think IgG became the dominant isotype in our serum, because we can regulate these pathways, IgE cannot. Yes?
Sorry. You show that the sialylation of the FC can increase the anti-inflammatory effect. How about in that action, do we need the FAB or
not? There's no requirement for FAB in that reaction. It's a pure FC reaction. So we've done the experiments with just FCs, either from IVIG, using only FC alone, or recombinant FCs in the absence of any FAB. It requires a hinge to maintain the structure to some degree, but otherwise, no, it doesn't require FAB. So it's truly antigen independent. It is a mechanism for globally suppressing inflammatory responses by serum IgG.
Okay, but in order for the antibody to be anti-cancer, for instance, in that, then you need a specific effect of the FAB.
Well, yes, so for an anti-cancer antibody, you would not want sialation on the FC.
Right.
For an anti-cancer antibody, you would want the FC to engage type 1 receptor, so it would be acylated, and number 2, it would be afucosylated to enhance cytotoxicity, ideally. And if you look at the antiviral antibodies, you saw that second peak of afucosylation occurring at week 3. Well, that's the population of IgGs that are actually actively involved in clearing the viral infection, killing the infected cells. So those are the effector stages of the antibody. So antibodies go through 2 stages. They go through the inductive stage, if you will, where they generate the high affinity molecules. Once you've generated those, then you want those to be the effector molecules to go on to clear the pathogen. And that's where the glycan will switch yet again to a different structure.
Okay, thank you.
Right.
Jim, for the sialation effect on anti-cancer activity?
Yes. Well, so rituximab is acylated. I think every anti-cancer antibody, fortunately, is acylated. That's because the cell lines that make them are very inefficient at sialation. So sialation of a fucosylated antibody would reduce its ADCC activity. That wouldn't be advantageous.
But if you remove the fucose.
Oh, if you remove fucose, then
sialylate with the 2,6 linkage.
Yeah, if you remove fucose, then sialation has no negative impact.
Right.
It doesn't, I mean, it may contribute to stability, it may contribute to pharmacokinetics, but it doesn't affect FC receptor binding because the afucosylation effect dominates that pathway.
Oh, we can talk about it.
Yes. Yeah. So
It does increase the binding.
It does increase your binding.
Yeah, the 2,6, but not the 2,3 linkage.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yes. Oh, here. Okay.
Thank you for the very nice talk. I just wonder, for the type 2 receptor DC sign you mentioned, they can bind the proteins to the glycan.
That's correct.
Sugar interaction,
yes.
Or through the protein-protein interaction.
Right. Yes.
Yeah, and so the downstream event of these two binding, are they different?
They're different, absolutely. So we did those experiments early on when we found DC sign or sign R1 in the mouse using heimannans, glycans that are the ligand for DC side through the other pathway, and they did not induce anti-inflammatory responses or IL-33 responses. So they're really quite a different signaling system. And I think it's in part because if you look at the structure of how the type 2 receptors bind, they form these huge networks on the cell surface. Because you have a 2-to-1 binding interaction, and you have multiple binding sites, you generate these large networks on the cell surface, and that leads to this DC sign signaling event.
More questions?
My question is based on your observation and hypothesis. If given the fact that you have all the toolkit, and what would be the most ideal designed or engineered antibody?
For what indication?
For short-term and long-term effect.
Against a tumor.
Right.
So I think for short-term effects, the most, what we've observed that the most effective changes are those that increase the binding to FCR3A in the human. Right? And that can be done by glycan modification, can be done by engineering the FC backbone to increase that binding affinity. And that leads to enhanced ADCC and enhanced tumor clearance. I think we'll probably get our first set of data for anti-HER2-new, which is now in a phase 3 study, that will tell us, which is FC engineered, not glycan engineered, to see if there's a difference between FC engineering and glyco engineering when it comes to those pathways. Hard to compare, you know, NHL or CLL to breast carcinoma, but you know, I think there's a reason to think you can get some information about that. For long-term effects, for inducing T-cell responses, our data suggests you have to have binding to the 2A receptor. And that, as far as I know, is only achieved by FC engineering to accomplish that. So now you can combine FC engineering with glycoengineering or FC engineering with multiple sites in order to achieve this pathway to induce long-term effects. And that's something that, to my knowledge, is not yet in clinical development, but I certainly hope it will be at some point so we can test the hypothesis.
Okay, yeah.
For some of the functions, FC media functions, such as the anti-inflammatory functions of IVIG, which does not involve the FB, do you think this kind of function can be replaced by antibodies against FC receptors?
Oh, so very different activities, a good question. So you can block FC receptors, you know, with antibodies, maybe with small molecules or peptides as well. That will give you a non-inflammatory response. It will be synergistic with the silated pathway, because remember, the silation pathway leads to the upregulation of inhibitory receptors, and blocking an activating receptor will prevent engagement of that pathway. So there are two distinct pathways. I think they could be, in fact, additive. But you know, blocking inhibitory activating receptors is certainly a consideration. I think the difficulty has always been the fact that there's a ubiquitous expression of these receptors on different tissue types. And I don't know what happened to the clinical development plan. I think there was some toxicity that was observed by blocking the 3A receptor, and I haven't seen any data on that. But in principle, that should be possible.
Okay, yeah.
Thank you, Professor, for nice talk. I just have a naive question. So anti-inflammatory activity of IgG, and if we compare with IgE, is the IgG activity is better than other immunoglobulin types? So
they're quite different. IgE, you know, binds to its high affinity receptor with essentially picomolar affinity. So it's bound to the cell type, to the mast cell, to the basophil, at any certain concentration of IgE that you would imagine. So their cross-linking occurs on the surface of the cell, as opposed to the ability. So if you introduce IgE into a system, it's rapidly bound by cells. And then the cells will have to find a target in order to mediate, for example, killing. And cross-linking by IgE is often accompanied with anaphylactic reactions. So I think IgE is a very difficult molecule to regulate when it comes to its ability to be used as a therapeutic entity. And I don't know of any cases where that's being tried. IgE is much better behaved. It binds with submicromolar affinity. It binds as immune complexes. It's driven by avidity. And you can regulate the binding activity very nicely. So you can coat a target cell with an antibody, and then it recruits the effector cells onto that target. So they're very different modes of action for them to be able to work.
Last one.
Thank you very much. So as current complex model of the FC and FC receptors, they sense the one-to-one binding, and the FC receptor only contact one phase of the FC. So can you provide some idea that can we asymmetrically engineering the FC to have better FC receptor affinity? Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, it certainly binds asymmetrically to the FC. I wouldn't say it binds only one phase, but it certainly binds asymmetrically to the two arms, to the A and B chains of the FC. All right, so can you engineer based on trying to increase the symmetry binding? So for the FC receptor or for the FC? So yeah, for the FC part, so there have been a lot of engineering efforts made that our engineering in that interface, and you can increase binding affinity quite dramatically. You know, two considerations are important. One, you don't want to increase binding affinity to the point where it becomes nanomolar affinity, because then it will bind monomerically, and you don't have the advantage of being able to code a target cell, for example. Instead, you'll be just binding and will be rapidly consumed by an effector cell. The second consideration is you want to get specificity. You don't want to bind all the Fc receptors equivalently, even though they all have a similar mode of binding. It's possible to distinctions between the receptors, so point mutations can influence one pathway or another, and that's the advantage of the Fc engineering. You could really selectively engage different receptors, activating inhibitory, different combinations thereof, and that creates a great opportunity for manipulating Fc as a therapeutic.
Okay, I hope you enjoyed the lecture, and I hope the lecture will inspire those who are working on antibodies who will pay more attention to the FC region of the antibody. Everybody just focus on the FAB. I think it's a very important area for development of therapeutic antibodies. So let's thank Professor Jeff Ravetch again for an exciting lecture.